What are some of the symptoms of stage 3 colorectal cancer? What is treatment like? Today, I'm going to talk with stage 3 rectal cancer survivor Cormeshia about these questions and much more. This video is part 3 in my Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month series, where I'm talking with other survivors of this crappy disease that have been diagnosed, starting from stage 1 and going all the way up to stage 4. If you're a regular viewer, you've probably already heard about my symptoms, diagnosis, and treatment plan for my stage 3 rectal cancer diagnosis. So I wanted to bring in someone different so that you can see how things can differ from person to person, from the symptoms we experience all the way through treatment. If you're new here, welcome. My name is Jelena, and I received my stage 3 rectal cancer diagnosis at age 34. This channel is here to talk all about colorectal cancer, what treatment is like, and how things just don't return back to normal once treatment is over. If you like what you've been hearing so far, click on the subscribe button below over here and make sure that you click on the bell to receive notifications so you'll be notified when all my latest videos are uploaded. Now let's talk with Cormeshia.
Welcome, Cormeshia. So first, can you tell us a little bit about yourself pre-cancer?
So for the most part, I'm pretty much still the same person. I just have cancer now. But pre-cancer, I'm a wife. I'm a mother of two. I have a 5-year-old and a 12-year-old. I work full-time for the Department of Defense, and I do photography part-time. And I'm also an enthusiast for anything involving beauty, fashion, and makeup.
So can you talk to us about the symptoms that you had leading up to your diagnosis? And then how long was it from when you first started experiencing those symptoms until you actually were diagnosed?
So leading up to my diagnosis, I've always been the type of person who was pretty regular. And it had gotten to a point to where I was excessively regular, which then turned into excessive gas, excessive bloating, more like explosive diarrhea. And I went through that for about 3 months. So early in 2019, I started seeing a GI doctor. And upon seeing me, she's like, oh, you have IBS diarrhea. And so I'm like, okay. And she told me to change my diet. I did the FODMAP diet, which basically takes out anything that could be an irritant, garlic, onions, tomatoes, just anything that might cause any irritation. So I did all that, and I slowly started putting things back into my diet, and I noticed that the bloating and the gas had subsided, but I was still having a lot of diarrhea. And then I started being constipated. So I saw her for about 9 months. And in seeing her, her main questions would be, do you have blood in your stool? Is your stool black? I would have a little blood in my stool, but I've had 2 children, so I do have hemorrhoids. So I'm like, I see a tinge of blood in my stool, but it's nothing alarming, nothing to make me be like, oh my gosh, you know, there's something wrong. And the color of my stool was always fine. My constipation had gotten so bad to where I basically was juicing twice a day and was only eating 1 meal a day. So I would get up in the morning and I would drink celery juice. I would drink a lot of celery juice. I would probably drink about 32 ounces of celery juice. And then I would drink beet juice to help regulate my bowels. And I would only eat dinner. That was the only time I was really just eating food. And it kept me to where I was more regular and not dealing with as much constipation. But I just knew something wasn't right. Even with doing the juicing and not eating all that much, the constipation became more and more frequent. And so the last time that I saw her, she had the same question, blood in your stool, is your stool black? And I'm like, no. I said, but when can I have a colonoscopy? Because things on the one end, they're getting better, but on the other end, they're not. And I would just feel better if you would just, you know, take a look in there and, you know, let me know that everything is okay or let me know what's going on. And it was so crazy because she kind of like reared back in her chair and went over my chart again. And she's like, oh, well, you have lost 15 pounds in the last month. Are you trying to lose weight? You know, and I'm like, it's not that I'm trying to lose weight, but I'm really not eating. So that's going to contribute to me not losing weight. You know, and she was like, you know, I think you are a good candidate for a colonoscopy. And I had my colonoscopy 3 days after that. When she did the colonoscopy, she told me that she found 3 polyps in a 3-centimeter mass. And then she told me that she took a piece of the mass off and that she would send it to have it biopsied. And she called me back on October the 14th, 2019 and told me that the mass was malignant.
So then did you find, what was your official diagnosis?
After I had, you know, scans done and everything, I was diagnosed with stage 3B rectal cancer.
Okay. So then what did your treatment look like for that?
My treatment plan was chemotherapy, radiation, and then they were going to do the colon resection. So I did 8 rounds of chemo. I was on oxaliplatin and 5-FU. And during my 28 sessions of radiation, I also took Zoloda. So I started chemo in, I think I started chemo the day before Thanksgiving, 2019. And then I had radiation started April and May in between there somewhere. And then I had my colon resection in July of 2020.
So during your colon resection, you got an ileostomy, correct?
I did. I got an ileostomy and I named my stoma Girlfriend.
What caused you to name her that, or what inspired you to name her Girlfriend?
Prior to my surgery, I did a lot of research and I was just trying to be able to be more comfortable with having an ileostomy. And a lot of people, I saw a lot of people like, it might help if you name your stoma, you know, so that, you know, you kind of feel like, I don't know, it's more a part of you. And I think it really helped because when I had my ileostomy, I literally talked to it like she was a girlfriend. You know, like, oh, girl, we're not doing this today, girl. No, you need to calm down. Or, oh, you're having a bad day today, girl. You know, like, what can I do to help you feel better? Things like that. So it did really help. And then plus with my children, it kind of helped me, especially with my 5-year-old, it kind of helped me to explain to her and talk to her about the things that were happening.
So then you had the ileostomy reversed, correct?
I did. I had the ileostomy reversed on November the 5th of 2020.
So since you've had your ileostomy reversed, how satisfied are you with the progress that you've made? It's been about 2 months now, I think.
Yeah, going on 3. I'm pretty satisfied. It was... it's funny because no matter how much research you do, no matter how much people tell you to prepare and give you tips and tricks on how to prepare, experiencing something firsthand is always kind of like, poof. And so it's been a ride. I will say that it's been a ride. It's been a ride. But I am happy that my bowels are a little more regulated now. Now I kind of know what my triggers are, whereas, you know, as soon as you have your reversal, it's just like everything sets you off. Anything's going to set you off. But now I pretty much know, you know, like, if I eat something that's got a lot of sugar in it, that's going to set me off. Fried foods set me off. Anything with a lot of spice is going to set me off. So,
okay. I was going to ask you, what were some of those things that do or that bother your system? So do you just completely avoid eating those things, or you're kind of like prepared and have a routine of things to do after you decide to like indulge in sweets or fried foods?
Because we are in the pandemic and I do a lot of sheltering in place. I'm less, I don't avoid things altogether. It just really depends on how I feel. If I really, really, really feel like, you know, I want something sweet, then I'm going to get something sweet. I just know that I'm going to pay the price later. It's a lot easier to deal with being at home. I'm sure if, you know, things were normal and I was up having to go to work or running errands, doing stuff like that, then I would be more cautious about what I eat. So it's kind of like a blessing and a curse, you know, the whole pandemic, because it has allowed me to not only go through all of my treatments, but it's allowed me to kind of feel my way around how to normalize my new normal.
Okay. Yeah, I can see that for sure. All right. So you recently had a PET scan and had a lung biopsy on one of two nodules that lit up during that PET scan. So what caused you to go in and get that PET scan, and what happens now?
So I had one nodule on each lung since my initial diagnosis. And they told me about it is when they told me about the rectal cancer, but they were so small that it was one of those, we're just going to monitor and see what happens type of thing. When I was on treatment, they started to shrink a little bit. Once I came off of treatment, they started growing. And so they're still small. One of them was 9 millimeters. The one on the left was 9 millimeters. The one on the right was, I believe it's 1.4 centimeters. So the thoracic surgeon decided to do a left VATS wedge resection on my left lung because the one on the left is on the surface. It was easy to get to. So I actually had the wedge reception on Monday, January the 25th, 2021. And I got my pathology reports back yesterday. And unfortunately, they are mets from the colon cancer. So now the plan is for the right side to have 5 rounds of radiation, the SBRT radiation, which is a high intensity radiation. I haven't had that scheduled yet. I'm pretty sure that will happen next week. So we're just praying that, you know, After we do this radiation, that'll get rid of the one on the right side, and we're done.
We're hoping. So
right.
Was the PET scan part of like your follow-up, like monitoring, or what caused you to do the PET scan that found these?
They wanted to do the PET scan because the nodules in my lungs were growing. And so I think he just wanted to be more certain that they were cancerous, because we all know that cancer lights up in PET scans. And so just to have more definitive results and to be able to better decide how to move forward with the treatment plan going forward.
Okay. Can you explain what the VATS is, what it stands for?
So the surgery I had on Monday was called a left VATS wedge resection video assisted thoracic surgery. So it's a minimally invasive surgery. I have 3 small incisions and they go in, they drop a camera in one of the holes, and then the other 2 holes, they, you know, put their instruments in and cauterize the piece of the lung that they're going to take off.
So can you offer some advice for somebody that's newly diagnosed at stage 3 to help them as they're navigating through treatment?
Definitely. The first bit of advice that I would give people is to do your research. I spent a lot of time going through my reports and Googling every big word, every medical term that I wasn't familiar with, until it almost gave me a headache. I would also say to understand how your health insurance works. Understand what the insurance is going to cover and what your financial responsibilities are going to be. And understand how, if you have a primary and a secondary insurance, understand how those two will work together, because medical insurance plays a huge, huge part in treatment. Also, talk to the billing department of the oncology center that you're talking with. Let them understand what you're able to do financially, and they have things that they can offer to help you. There's programs that can help you. There are different donors that can help you. You know, just know that there are avenues to assist you financially during this process. I will also advise to advocate. Ask all the questions. I've asked questions before, and I've had doctors literally burst out in laughter, like, what made you think of that? You know, and it's like, this is my body. This is what made me think of that. Speaking of asking questions, the number one thing that I would say, especially for women, is if you're having, even if you're just having chemo, but especially if you're having radiation to your pelvis, get your gynecologist in the loop. Because from my experience, oncologists and your radiation team, they kind of skirt over the whole vaginal atrophy, or you might experience a little discomfort during sex. They kind of brush over that. And it's a lot more serious than that. Vaginal atrophy is very real and it's very life-changing. So for those of us who are still young, it can really change a relationship. Mm-hmm. And so just make sure that you keep your gynecologist in the loop with what's going on.
That's some great advice and some great tips on like helping through the financial part as well, because that is a huge barrier for a lot of people to get the right treatment and to continue treatment, or it's just a huge cloud like hovering over their heads, because it is not cheap to go through cancer care in the United States.
At all.
That's some great advice.
Thank you.
So you started a new project on Instagram called Dastardly Adventures, and you've also got a website for it. So what motivated you to create this?
What motivated me to create Dastardly Adventures is when I initially got my diagnosis, and I am an Instagram fanatic. I love Instagram. I'm a hashtag queen. I mean, people can ask me the simplest questions and I'm like, go on Instagram and search the hashtag. You can find any answer that you want. And so when I was searching, you know, colon cancer, colorectal cancer, I did not see people who looked like me. And I feel like it's very important for Black, Indigenous, and people of color to tell their stories. I know for Black people, we tend to, you know, not just really want to talk about it. You know, it's more of a like, oh, well, you know, I made it through. That's the important part. But no, you really need to let people know your experience, because your story can help someone else. Your transparency can help someone else. I have a few people that I've met through my journey, and you know, they're just like, Cormeshia, I was going through this and I remember, you know, you said something about it and that really helped me. I had a friend who recently got a permanent colostomy bag, and he was just so upset. And I was like, go to my Instagram page and look at some things. And you know, he's like, well, can you help me? And I have like all of these pictures, and I'm like, yeah, let me send you a picture. Like, this is what's gonna happen. And he's just like, oh my gosh, you know, you have been such a godsend right now, because I just didn't know what to do. And so it's important. Community is important. You know, it's important. The community as a whole is important, and I've learned so much from our community, but there's also just something about having people that look like you, who you know have experienced some of the same intimate things that you have experienced. And so that is why I created Dastardly Adventures. And I also wanted it to be a little lighthearted. Even though we're talking about a very serious subject, I wanted it to be something to where you can look at it and kind of get some facts, learn from other people's experiences, but that it not just be such a negative or a place of detriment, you know? So that was my motivation behind it. And also it helps me.
So if people are interested in following it or looking it up, where can they find it?
You can find us at www.dastardlyadventures.com. And on Instagram, we're dastardly_adventures.
Okay, great.
Thank you so much, Cormeshia, for taking the time to share your story with us. If you enjoyed listening to her story, click on the like button right down here to show her some love. If you missed the first part of this series, you can click on the playlist right up here to get caught up on the videos that you missed, or you can click on the video right below here. That's one that YouTube thinks you'd really enjoy from my channel. Thank you for watching.